Welcome to Ring of Fire, I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. Pharmaceutical companies are consolidating, creating massive monopolies over your medications. We'll tell you how this will affect drug prices. Emails show that Sony Pictures has softened the football film Concussion to avoid backlash from the NFL, so we'll examine the dangers that professional athletes face from head injuries. And Dick Cheney says he has absolutely no apologies to make for the Iraq War. We'll bring you more on tonight's backstory. That's what's coming up. You've just entered the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
Congress is back in session today, and if there's one person that's not happy to be back at work, it's Republican Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell. McConnell is in the unenviable position of having to lead his Republicans in a string of fights that he doesn't really want to be involved with. The first fight is against Planned Parenthood, where his party is trying to strip away the group's federal funding over bogus claims that they are harvesting fetal tissue and selling it to the highest bidder. Even though the video evidence of this was shown to have been faked, McConnell's Republican co-workers still want to defund Planned Parenthood, which would cripple vital services for women in the United States. The second fight, a fight that McConnell and his Republicans have already lost, is the fight against the international nuclear agreement with Iran. McConnell and the war hawks in Congress did not want to see the president succeed in the area of foreign policy, but with a veto-proof majority of senators now supporting the deal, McConnell and the Republicans have absolutely no chance of winning this battle. The biggest problem for McConnell right now is that he has to lead the Republicans with an increased sense of caution right now. We're coming up on an election year where 26 of his Republican members in the Senate will be up for re-election, while only 10 Democratic seats are up for grabs. The balance of power in the Senate could dramatically shift to a filibuster-proof majority after the next election, and McConnell knows that. If he acts too boldly and prevents action on issues from taking place, his party could suffer in the election by being cast as obstructionists. On the other hand, if he agrees too much with Obama, his base is going to get angry, which is going to result in lower Republican voter turnout, which will then end up costing the Republicans the White House. So Mitch McConnell has a very tough road ahead of him, but it's only because this is the kind of party that he has helped to create. And there's even more bad news lurking out there for the Republican Party. Dick Cheney is back in the media spotlight. During an interview with CNN last week, Cheney was absolutely clear that he had no regrets about the invasion of Iraq and that he doesn't believe any apologies are owed to anyone. Here's what we know today. We know that before the attacks of 9/11, Dick Cheney was meeting secretly with members of the energy industry where they took a map of Iraq and divided the country into different segments, one for each member of the oil industry. We know that the intelligence used to convince Congress and the public to support the war was manipulated to falsely claim that Saddam Hussein was building weapons of mass destruction. We know that the Cheney administration authorized and encouraged the torture of detainees. We know that the policies of Bush and Cheney helped to increase and embolden the ranks of Al-Qaeda and ISIS. And we know that close to 5,000 U.S. troops have lost their lives fighting in Iraq. Those are just a few of the things that Dick Cheney could apologize for, but instead, he insists that he has no apologies to make. Now, the timing of the release of his new book is not a coincidence. Cheney knows that Obama has been very strong on foreign policy, which gives the Democratic Party the upper hand heading into an election year. Cheney's hoping to rewrite history so that his party won't have to keep answering tough questions about the Iraq invasion, because as we've seen from the candidates so far, the GOP presidential field have absolutely failed miserably when they're asked about the Iraq invasion. But Americans aren't stupid. They aren't going to buy into Cheney's false narrative about the invasion of Iraq. Not this time. And as if the combined incompetence of Mitch McConnell and Dick Cheney wasn't bad enough, there's a third issue facing Republicans today. Environmental groups are no longer sitting on the sidelines, and a flurry of new attack ads are slated to hit the airwaves, attacking Republican Senators Richard Burr, Rob Portman, Pat Toomey, and Ron Johnson for their opposition to the EPA's new carbon emission rules. The League of Conservation Voters, the NRDC, the Sierra Club, and the Environmental Defense Fund are putting out the ads in an attempt to let the public know where these candidates stand on environmental issues. Now, this is a great step being taken by these environmental groups because it shows that they can be just as aggressive as their opposition, and that's something that's been mostly missing from environmentalists. My only hope is that these attack ads continue to fly throughout this election cycle and that we see even more science-denying politicians get put into the crosshairs. The pharmaceutical industry holds enormous power over our health, our politicians, and even our economy. With their products being a necessity for a large part of the population, they have the ability to charge exorbitant amounts of money for their products, with the only relief for consumers coming in the form of generic drugs. But today, that relief is disappearing, and I have attorney Stephen Berg with me to tell us how this is happening. Stephen, one of the biggest issues with generic drugs is the fact that that's all that most people in this country are able to afford. There is this waiting period, 10 years or however long before a name brand drug can go generic. But once they do, people can start affording it, makes their lives a heck of a lot easier than having to pay, $700 or $800 per prescription. But today, that generic industry is trying to capitalize on the market and finally start pulling in the profits that Big Pharma is, essentially by gouging consumers. Lay out for us a little bit what's happening with the generic drug industry here.
So what's happened in the last few years is a number of things. There's been a consolidation of the generic drug industry, started with Teva, and they've consolidated with a number of other pharmaceutical competitors to the point where now they're the single biggest generic drug manufacturer in the country. In the world, in fact.
Well, the big pharmaceutical companies, when we talk about that, like Pfizer and Merck and all those folks, they create life-saving medications. They also create medications that can absolutely ruin people's lives, as we've seen through litigation for decades now. But one of the worst things that they do in the United States that they do not do overseas is the issue of this price gouging. I mean, there are some pills out there that have a 20,000% markup on them. Xanax is one of them. A few others. Zoloft was one. And so the generic really was the only version of a pill that people could afford. And so now that these pharmaceutical companies led by Teva, They're consolidating. They want a piece of that pie, don't they? I mean, is that what we're seeing here? Is that why all of these generics are starting to band together, under the same roof to get a little bit larger share of profits here?
That's correct. They're absolutely coming together so that they don't want competition. I mean, the way I see this for these generic drugs right now is they're cowards. These are cowards that don't want competition driving down the price of the goods. And so they're trying to consolidate. And, ultimately, at the end of the day, the consumers are the ones that are being hurt the most on this. Something that I saw recently, this was a shadowy forecast of things to come, was the FTC did a report in 2010 that talked about another example that was costing consumers is the pay for delay. And the FTC forecasted that in the next 10 years, so from 2010 to 2020, just the pay for delay was going to cost consumers $35 billion.
Yeah, absolutely unbelievable. But yeah, it is believable. I mean, that's what the pharmaceutical industry is in the business of doing right now. They're no longer in the business of saving lives, of developing new medications. They're in the business of making money, which absolutely fine in a capitalist society like what we have. But there's got to be a trade-off here. They cannot just continue to bully consumers by upping the prices, because for something like this, there's no alternative. It really is. I mean, pharmaceutical industry has a monopoly on saving lives, unfortunately. But, back to this issue of the generics, what are we beginning to see already as far as price increases for consumers? Because some of the numbers I've seen, prices are shooting up, double, triple, quadruple what they were just 2 years ago, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. And a good example of that is Teva, where they make a antibiotic called doxycycline. And this has been a generic for years, in fact, 3 decades. And you would think that the price would be very cheap because of that. And, it went from, in 2013, it went from $1.20 to six months later. So from October 2013, 6 months later, we saw that price soar to over $100, and that is a cost for the pharmacy.
Jeez, that is unbelievable here. And so another issue that we have with the generic pharmaceutical industry, in addition to them now jumping on this price gouging bandwagon, is the fact that this industry is regulated far less than the main pharmaceutical industry, the name brand drugs. They do not have to go through the same testing. They do not have to, in most cases, carry the same warning. And as I'm to believe, litigation against generic manufacturers is a lot more difficult to reach success than against the big name brands. You may be able to help us out a little bit with that, but is that the case? I mean, generics have a bit of immunity, don't they?
They do, that's right. There is federal preemption that says the courts have given basically total immunity, other than a couple exceptions, to generic manufacturers on a failure to warn type of case against them. And so literally they have immunity. I mean, this is one of those hot button subjects for me. Obviously, my grandparents, I've seen what the spike in their generic drugs that they take has done, but then you couple that with the consolidation and what's going on with these pay for delay contracts, and then they have total immunity. What we're seeing is these are coward drug companies that are market manipulators, and ultimately it's hurting the consumers. Going back to the immunity issue, the generic drug manufacturers, if they know a drug is bad and it's causing adverse effects, they have no obligations there.
That's something that was handed down by the U.S. Supreme Court. Federal government helped them get there. Federal government has been very slow to act on anything within the pharmaceutical industry. They're not addressing the price issue whatsoever. In fact, with the Affordable Care Act, they put in a provision that said we're not allowed, the government is not allowed to negotiate drug prices with the drug industry. So I guess in the last minute we have here, is the federal government doing anything about this consolidation issue? I mean, we have generic companies forming these miniature monopolies, which a monopoly is absolutely against antitrust laws. So is the federal government doing anything about this, or are they just letting it happen?
They're not doing enough. I mean, quite frankly, they're letting the consolidations happen. And, our system, our capitalist system, is set up to have a free market economy. And essentially what these generic drug manufacturers are doing is changing that. They're afraid of competition. And quite honestly, the government hasn't stepped up enough to get it done. Now, we do have Senator Sanders is, he's proposed that a new legislation that essentially bars generic manufacturers of drugs raising prices beyond inflation. And that's something that would be very helpful. Now, there hasn't been enough support on that, and it's so the prospect of that passing it is not looking great, but that's definitely a step in the right direction. We need more people to step up and speak about this on programs like this. I mean, something that's so unique here is this program can talk about these issues,
right?
Where other programs, they can't, because they have the advertising budget from the pharmaceutical companies of millions and millions of dollars.
Exactly. Well, you know, that's a great thing to point out to the audience, you know, in the few seconds we have left. Whenever you have a chance, flip over to Fox, to MSNBC, to CNN at any point during the day and count how many pharmaceutical industry commercials you see in one commercial block. We have TVs in our office going 24/7 with these channels on. Anytime you look up there, you're going to see an advertisement for some new drug that the industry is trying to push on consumers. So they're major advertisers, and so those networks will never tell these stories, and it does a real disservice to consumers. Stephen Berg, thank you for talking with us today. This is a phenomenal story. We will keep on it, and thank you for talking with us.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Recently, news broke that Sony had softened the upcoming football movie Concussion in order to avoid backlash from the NFL. The film will take a look at a fictionalized account of what happens to a player who suffers a concussion on the field. But in real life, the NFL has done everything possible to cover up the dangers of head injuries to players, and about a year ago, Mike Papantonio discussed the problem with attorney Chris Seeger. So let's take a look at that interview.
Chris, when you have an industry that is worth $9 billion and year in, year out, they're making billions and billions of dollars, it's hard to get them to pay attention to what they ought to be doing for the players. The NFL is the best example of what I'm talking about here. You just took that issue on. What did you find, Chris?
Well, I mean, I think what you just said is a fair conclusion that we came to, and we see it in every case. You know, at the end of the day, the players were commodities. And, you know, we brought this case initially, Mike, to get relief to the really sick players. What we found and what we learned in the process were that there were hundreds, if not thousands, of players that are really struggling with these head injuries. And we wanted to bring this case to get immediate relief to them and to make sure that we could get the players who are retired, who are asymptomatic today, get them tested and make sure that they're going to be okay.
One thing that I think the public missed about this case, I would hear some commentaries about it, and it's almost as if they didn't understand how impossible this case was, and then y'all pulled it off anyway. Talk about the obstacles that you had to overcome just to be able to get the sickest of the sick players. I mean, the people suffering from dementia, people suffering from Parkinson's-like disease, people that basically were paralyzed as a practical purpose from repeated concussions. How difficult was it to even get the NFL to pay attention to this?
You know, Mike, that's a really good question, and it's one that I haven't been asked yet, and I appreciate you asking that. You know, when I first looked at this case many years ago, I had players coming to me and complaining that they were being, you know, railroaded by the disability board, they weren't being taken care of in the NFL and the Players Association in the benefits that were created. These guys were being rejected left and right. I looked at this case, and I initially considered rejecting it because I thought it was an incredibly difficult case. As I learned more about it and I saw what went on within the NFL, especially in the period of the early 90s to the early 2000s, the denial, not informing players of what was going on, and also, you know, basically having an anti-notice campaign, that is, publishing literature that went against the scientific literature. But they were still, notwithstanding that bad conduct, they were still difficult cases. And I remember about 2 or 3 weeks before we actually settled the case, there were commentators, professional commentators on the air saying we would never get a nickel. We would be fighting for years. These players would die before they'd see anything. Ironically, once we got the settlement, some of those very same commentators were arguing we didn't get enough. So
I remember that. I remember that very well. And I think as you look at this story, I think one thing that it did, this case has raised awareness not just for NFL, but for the, you know, for the child playing high school football or the college athlete. And now we know, I mean, it's no guesswork here, is there, Chris? There's no guesswork of what the science of this is. Although we saw the NFL try to buy what I call biostitutes, try to buy science by hiring scientists that would say any damn thing they wanted for the right amount of money. So that prevented any change. But now people are aware of what's going on, don't you think? That's a positive here, isn't it?
Mike, it's a positive. I think it's been a game changer on the concussion front. My own, I have a young son who plays soccer. They're not teaching them at a young age to head the ball. They want to avoid concussions and subconcussive hits as well. They're teaching players to hit safely. By the way, money that we've obtained in the settlement, we're donating through the education fund we have to teaching young players how to hit safely to avoid these injuries. But maybe even more importantly for the players that are playing today, and I know that the public thinks of them as highly paid and they know what they're getting into, but we've made the rules of the game, I think, with this litigation and also the NFL realizing this is the right thing to do. We've changed the rules in the game. These guys are not being put right back in the game after they've been knocked out.
Chris, let's even defend the players a little bit more. You always hear the argument, well, gee whiz, the players take this on. They're paid big money, and they run the risk. It's a little different story, though. When you really tell the truth about the story is players were asking questions. The question was, look, I've had three concussions, team doctor. Would you tell me, does this mean anything? And the same damn team doctor would go out and write an article about how it doesn't mean anything, how it's a transient injury, there's no problem. Basically, what was happening is the players were being lied to in a very organized kind of way by these scientists that they would find at a university making $100,000 a year, and they'd say, how would you like to make $500,000 for writing a paper that is an absolute lie? Yeah. And so that's kind of in defense of the player that says, well, gee, they lied to me.
Once again, you nailed it. I mean, they had a guy that they put in charge of their mild traumatic brain injury committee who wasn't even a neurologist. He was a rheumatologist. And this rheumatologist was able to recruit other scientists. And they did exactly what you just said. They put their names on papers saying there are none of these diseases are related to concussions. So even if the player wanted to find out the risks, there would be this published literature out there that denied, you know, let's call it independent medical science. So you're absolutely right on that. And the players, look, let's be frank also. They may have bargained for a lot of pain. They know they're playing a rough game. They're big, they're strong, they're athletic, they're hitting each other. But they bargained for neck injuries. They bargained for knee injuries, back injuries. I don't think these guys knew that they were the kind of damage they were doing to their brain.
I think the startling thing about it is you hear these stories that they emerge one at a time where you have a player that is suffering from depression. They have illnesses that look like Alzheimer's disease. When they do an autopsy on the brain, it looks like a brain of an 85-year-old man. That individual ends up committing suicide, and they're seeing this more and more in the NFL. And I guess the point is, it's all about choice, isn't it? Isn't it? Don't you at least give the player the choice to say, listen, you can do this and you can make millions of dollars, but you're not going to, A, you're not going to live as long. B, if you do live long, you're not going to have a quality of life that's worth a damn. And it's all about simply having the decency to give them choice. And we ought to do the same thing. And this is what your lawsuit, I think, has been so incredibly important. It's incredibly important to let parents know that when you put that child out on the field, you're being lied to by the manufacturing of the helmets sometime, aren't you?
Yeah, and Mike, I think you just nailed it. The importance of this case was to try to get back to a way of playing the game that avoids the head-to-head collisions. And if you're going to do that, that's fine. But like you just said, it is a matter of choice. And look, there are a number of players that have been interviewed by the press that have said, you know, I understand now everything there is to know about concussions, the diseases they lead to, and I wouldn't do a thing different. That's okay. That does not undermine what we did. What we're talking about is that when you're putting people in harm's way, when you're giving them a drug that causes injuries, when you're putting them on the football field, you just tell them the truth.
And if you tell them the truth and then they make that decision, that's perfectly understandable. But here, the most important thing is at least the parents who make the decision to let that child play football understand, A, there is a way to play it safely, and B, understand with your eyes wide open that you may suffer consequences in later years. Just give them the choice. If they then choose to do that, that's what this lawsuit really is all about. Chris Seeger, again, great work. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you very much.
Are you ready?
The PAP attack.
A few years ago, conservative talkers dominated the media. About 90% of all the talkers on both radio and TV had a conservative slant. Thanks to social media, progressive websites, and Free Speech TV and RT Network, an imbalance has shifted slightly. But conservatives are still the dominant voices on the air today. This dominance is mainly due to the fact that most conservative voters actually yearn for authoritarianism. They prefer to be told how to think and how to feel. Psychological studies abound about that detail, the inner workings of the conservative brain. And it almost always comes back that they need to be given their marching orders. They need to be told what to do because they aren't independent thinkers. That's why the media is oversaturated with conservative talkers. And that's also why it's so much fun to watch the conservative media tear itself apart during this election cycle. Rush Limbaugh, Glenn Beck, and the freaks over at Fox News have been pushing the Republican Party further and further to the right, and now their ugly personalities have personified themselves through none other than Donald Trump. And rather than trying to distance themselves and come across as the sane choice for the GOP, the other Republican presidential candidates are now having to jump on the Donald Trump conservative media craze train wagon in order to stay relevant. We saw this play itself out with Donald's insane proposal to essentially repeal the 14th Amendment and deny birthright citizenship to children of illegal immigrants that were born in the United States, by the way. Trump and his flying monkeys is trying to take America back to the Dred Scott days of history where former slaves and their children were denied citizenship for the sole purpose of preventing them from voting. Within hours of Trump's policy proposal, we saw other candidates, Scott Walker, Lindsey Graham, Ted Cruz, and Jeb Bush, try to out-crazy Trump's craziness on immigration. The reason this has happened is because the conservative media has been blaming immigrants for everything for years. They tell their viewers that Joe Sixpack lost his job because they gave it to illegal immigrants. They tell us we better carry a weapon at all times because an illegal immigrant's going to kill us if we aren't ready to shoot first. They stoke the conservative base's fear. They tell them who to blame. And then they tell them that Republicans are the only ones that can solve this imaginary problem. That's the key to conservative media success. But the burn down of conservative talk goes even further than anti-immigrant hate speech that we're hearing today. The lunatic fringe of the party, the fringe that conservative media created, is now pushing the media to be even crazier, to go further and further to the right. Donald Trump picked a fight with Fox News after the first debate, and he won. He got the network to back down by threatening not to come on again. The result was that the network apologized. Can you imagine? They apologized and they welcomed Trump back with open arms and sent Megyn Kelly on an unplanned vacation while they smoothed things over with the crazy Donald. This rightward shift of the media has taken an enormous toll on the Republican Party to the point that we have old guard Republicans out there talking about how dangerous the right-wing media has become and how it actually could end up costing the GOP this election because they're forcing fringe candidates on a moderate public, a public that's actually turned off by Trump's hatred of immigrants and his disdain for women. This really is the perfect example of Frankenstein's monster. The conservative media helped create a lunatic fringe, and now that fringe monster has started bossing the conservative media around. Meanwhile, we can all sit back and watch as the right-wing talking heads burn down their own party. Good riddance.
And that's all the time we have for today. But you can get more news, video, and commentary on our website at ringoffireradio.com. And you can subscribe to our daily podcast. Just go online to rofpodcast.com. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.